Can you tell us about these tools?
Sure. Well, the one that's a little different than what most conservators would use, or paper conservators, is this, I guess it's a dental mirror. But it was really helpful for the kite because, you know, I couldn't flip it over. It was so damaged that I had to work from the front and stabilize it from the front before I could flip it over. So this allowed me to see what was going on underneath. I had it raised up on foam blocks, and I could look at, you know, if I was doing a mend, I could look at it from the bottom, and I could look at it from the top. It was very helpful.
Nice. How about this one?
So this is a bone folder. This is very common tool in a paper conservator's tool chest and a book binder's tool chest. You can use it to crease paper. If I put down a mend, I would burnish that mend, so burnishing is sort of smoothing out and calendaring something. Bone folders have a lot of uses. Sorry.
What about the
tweezers? Well, sometimes I was working with little tiny bits of paper. They're very, very sharp. You don't want to drop them because you could hurt yourself or bend the tips.
Those look a little more delicate than the tweezers I might have at home.
Yes, they are delicate, but they're very useful for paper.
Now, is this a dental tool?
I don't know if this is actually a dental tool. It's a little probe, and I use it to test if a pigment is flaking. So I look under the microscope, and I just very gently touch little areas of the pigment, and if they wiggle, then I know that it's loose, and I have to readhere it back to the paper support.
Wow.
This is a microspatula. This is also very useful for paper conservators. Let's say I paste out a strip of Japanese paper. I'm about to put down a mend. I put down that mend. It dries. And then I can go underneath. This is very thin. And I'll just slide underneath to release any of the parts that I don't want to stick anymore.
So when you talk about adding a mend, what does that mean?
So if you have a tear in a piece of paper, as I was talking about before with the Japanese paper linings and bends, this is a Japanese paper. It's very thin.
Okay.
And I would take just a very thin strip, a narrow strip, something sort of like that. It has these feathered edges. That's the long fiberedness of that paper. I would paste it out with wheat starch paste and then apply it to, let's say I have a tear. And so I would apply that over the tear, and it reinforces the tear and stabilizes that area. And then what I could do, you know, is take my bone folder, push it down a little bit. I could take my microspatula.
Now, do you do that on the top or the bottom, typically?
The mends go on the bottom. The mends go on the back, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
It looks like you have a really sharp knife.
I have there. A scalpel, yes. You know, sometimes you need to trim your mends. You need to cut very straight edges on your sheets of paper. So I use a scalpel, and then just a regular brush to paste out mends. And
so, what's that?
So this is a weight. It's a little pouch. This is linen, and inside are lead shots. And so we can make them any weight that we want, which is very useful actually for the kites, because if I need to weight a very fragile area, I can remove some of the lead shot and make a very, very light weight that's still, you know, soft and won't damage anything.
Now, what is your background on knowing how to do all of this?
So I have a master's degree in art conservation with a specialism in paper conservation, works of art on paper.
So what did you actually have to study to become a paper conservator?
So in order to go to graduate school for paper conservation, or conservation in general, you're required to take several chemistry courses, art history courses, studio art courses, and then also many of the graduate programs like you to have hundreds of hours of conservation practice. So it's very common for someone that wants to go into conservation, they'll be an intern, and they'll be what's called a pre-program intern. So they are, you know, they intend to go into a program, but they're still working on getting all of their requirements.
That's pretty interesting that you had to take art history and chemistry classes.
Yeah. I mean, conservation is a wide range of materials. Paper, you know, is more, there are less things to deal with in terms of materials, but you have to understand how your objects are going to age. You have to understand how your objects are, you know, working together, you know, how the materials on the objects are working together. With paper in particular, you have to understand if a pigment is acidic, if it's going to cause deterioration, if the housing that, let's say, a document is kept in could be an acidic housing. So you have to understand, you know, how these materials all work together.
Wow. Now, I noticed earlier that when we were looking at the kite, you were touching it with your bare hands.
Yes.
Why is that?
Yes. So it's very common to think that white cotton gloves are the best way to handle paper. From a conservation perspective and a preservation perspective, we feel that it's actually safer for the object if we wash our hands, remove the excess oil, and then you're able to really feel what the paper is like. You can know if it's brittle, you can understand how thin it is, how thick it is, how to manipulate the paper actually in your hands. And with gloves, you just don't get that tactile experience.
Wow. Well, thank you so much for showing us your tools and how you work on the kite.
Thank you.